Well, hello, this is Pastor Milky, and we are going to be moving on to Lesson 10 this week. We've already looked at Jesus' work, his office as prophet, Jesus' work, his office as priest. Now we're going to look at that third work or office of Jesus, understanding Jesus' work as king. I apologize for my voice sounding kind of rough today. Got some kind of a virus thing going on. Hopefully my voice will last through the whole lesson. So we will get moving. To understand Jesus' work as king, we're going to first look at John 10, 1 to 18, often called the Good Shepherd chapter. Amen, amen, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the door, but climbs in by some other way is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. The doorkeeper opens the door for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own sheep, he walks ahead of them. The sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will never follow a stranger, but will run away from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this illustration in speaking to the people, but they did not understand what he was telling them. So Jesus said again, "Amen, amen, I tell you, I am the door for the sheep. All who came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. A thief comes only to steal and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired man, who is not a shepherd, does not own the sheep. He sees the wolf coming, leaves the sheep, and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the sheep and scatters them. Because he works for money, he does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I also have other sheep that are not of the sheep pen. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. Then there will be one flock and one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me, because I lay down my life so that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own. I have the authority to lay it down, and I have the authority to take it up again. This is the commission I received from my Father." According to verses 4 and 5 there, how trusting are sheep of their shepherd? Well, Jesus says they listen to the shepherd's voice and follow wherever the shepherd goes. They know their shepherd's voice, and they follow him in that voice wherever he goes. What was an important part of a shepherd's job as he protected his sheep? If you remember from our reading, it was to fight off predators who were trying to hurt the sheep. There would be wolves and other wild animals that would want to try to kill the sheep. There would be thieves, robbers that would want to try and steal the sheep. And so one of the shepherd's job was to protect the sheep from such enemies. And now we think about that from the perspective of Jesus. What did we need our shepherd Jesus to do for us? Think about our enemies that we need Jesus to protect us from. Notice he protects us to the point that he even dies for us. He even gives his life up for the sheep. And so, generally, Shepherds were very protective of their sheep, and so is Jesus. He's willing to do anything at all to guard and protect us. What did Jesus mean when speaking to his Jewish disciples? He said that he had sheep that were not part of his current sheep pen. Well, he's talking about the fact that even though he came from the Jewish people and that he conducted his ministry by and large among the Jewish people, he did not come only for the Jewish people. There were people who were not Jewish who would come to believe in Jesus. And we're among them, right? Gentiles, non-Jews. He's talking about those that are not Jewish that would also believe in Jesus. That was true already in the Old Testament. You think of some of the non-Jews like Rahab, Naaman, Syrian army commander. You think about Ruth. All three are good examples that they were not Jewish people, and yet they believed in the one who true God, who had promised to send a savior, and that would only continue and actually expand after Jesus' resurrection and ascension into heaven. A shepherd might lay down his life for the benefit of the sheep. In everyday life in Israel, a shepherd might go so far to, in fighting off a predator or defending the sheep against the robber, might lay down his life for his sheep. But as our shepherd, Jesus certainly would lay down his life for his sheep. But what is unique about Jesus? Okay, there were other shepherds who laid down their life for their sheep, but there's something about Jesus that only he did, and that is he would not stay dead. If other shepherds died for their sheep, they would stay dead. But Jesus did not stay dead, did he? On the third day, he rose again. Now, this slide helps us see this connection, because you may be thinking at this point, we're supposed to be talking about Jesus as king, so why are we talking about Jesus as shepherd? Well, here's why. In the Old Testament, God often referred to kings as shepherds of his people. For example, Psalm 78. Then he chose David, his servant, and took him from the sheep pens. David was a shepherd. He brought him from following the mother sheep to shepherd his people Jacob and his possession Israel. So he shepherded them with a sincere heart, and with skillful hands he led them. David was a shepherd whom God chose to be king of Israel. And when he talks about shepherding his people Jacob and his possession Israel, shepherding them with a sincere heart and skillful hands he led him, he's not talking about David's work in feeding, leading, guiding, protecting actual sheep, but the people of Israel. And so I want you to think about is, how is the work of a king similar to the work of a shepherd? Well, a king guards and protects his people just like a shepherd does for the sheep. A king, one of the main jobs of a king is to protect and guard his people. And so we look at the term king, and we can define king as a person chosen to lead and protect a group of people. Person chosen to lead and protect a group of people. Now, let's take a look at what Jesus protects us from. We're going to look at three passages, and answer the question, how did Jesus serve as our king during his earthly ministry? 1 Corinthians 15, 56 to 57. The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. There, Jesus guards and protects us, wins the victory over sin for us. Sin is our big enemy, isn't it? Sin is the cause of all of our problems, physically, emotionally, spiritually. No, not some specific sin, but just sin in general. We look around our world, the problems in the world are all caused by sin. The fact that this is a fallen world, we are sinful human beings living in a fallen world with fallen bodies. That's why people get sick. Again, not because of some specific sin, but sin in general. And so Jesus, by his death on the cross, took away our sin. 2 Timothy 1:9 to 10. He saved us and called us with a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began, and it has now been revealed through the appearance of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Another enemy that our King Jesus defends us against is death. The wages of sin is death. Because of sin, there is death, including, we talked about it before, temporal death, spiritual death, and ultimately eternal death. Jesus has delivered us from that. He protects us from that. Even though we die physically, since he has given us new birth, we who are born spiritually dead have been born again by water and the Spirit through faith in Jesus. Now, as children of God, we never really die. Even physical death cannot really harm us. We pass through physical death unscathed, as it were, as Jesus now turns physical death into the doorway to eternal life in heaven. And how did Jesus serve as our king also? 1 John 3:8, the second part. I'll read the whole passage. The one who continues to sin is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. And then look at the last past part. This is why the Son of God appeared, to destroy the works of the devil. Finally, this is why Jesus came, to destroy the works of the devil, to negate all the works of the devil, to undo all the damage, to reverse everything that the devil has done. And so he has taken away the devil's power to tempt. Devil still tries, and sometimes we listen, but again, we don't have to, remember. We can resist the devil's temptations in Christ. And secondly, he takes away that devil's power to accuse us, right? Because the devil likes to accuse us that because of our sin, we can't be God's children. And Jesus takes that accusation away, because he says, I've taken away your sin. In God's eyes, you're not guilty. So how did Jesus serve as our king during his earthly ministry? When Jesus died and rose again, he defeated our enemies, sin, death, and the devil. Jesus' death was the death of sin. Jesus' resurrection, the death of death. And both were the death of the devil's power to control us any longer. Okay, let's that's how Jesus acted as our king in the past, and obviously its blessings are still present in the present. But let's look at how Jesus is also still acting as our king. He's taking care of our enemies. And yet he is still very active as our king right now. Ephesians 1, 18 to 23. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you may know the hope to which he has called you. Just how rich his glorious inheritance among the saints is, and just how surpassingly great his power is for us who believe. It is as great as the working of his mighty strength, which God worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. Just stop there for a moment and look at 19:20. How great God's power is for us who believe, as great as the working of his mighty strength, which God worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. It had to be that way because we were spiritually dead, right? God used the same power that he used to raise Jesus from the dead to raise us from our spiritual death and rescue us from eternal death. And now he says he seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. You already know that that right hand isn't a place, but it's a position of authority. And notice how much, far above all rule, authority, power, and dominion, and above every name that is given, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. God also placed all things under his feet and made him head over everything for the church. The church is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. What is the hope? And when the Bible talks about hope, it doesn't mean I hope it doesn't rain today or snow today. I hope, you know, the Packers don't lose. Those are, you know, wishes, right? We don't know if that's going to happen. When the Bible talks about hope, probably a good way to translate it would be certain expectation. There's no doubt about the outcome. We just have to wait to see it happen. And so what's God called us? What certainty has God called us to? The forgiveness of sins and eternal life. There's no doubt about that. God has forgiven our sins. And God has provided and promised eternal life to us. How does Paul describe Jesus' position as king now since his resurrection and ascension? Again, now we're talking about that state of exaltation when he has taken back full use and constant use of his power and authority. Paul describes it as he's above every other power and authority. There's nobody with more power and authority than our Lord Jesus. Nobody. Nobody. Jesus served as our king during his earthly ministry by defeating our spiritual enemies. How does he continue to serve as our king today? Look at verses 22 to 23. He rules and works all things for our eternal good. Notice, for whom is he doing all this? Who is he ruling over everything? For whose good? The church. Believers. You and me. Everything Jesus is doing is in our best interest so that we get to heaven. Now, yet we have to admit, in this world, this side of heaven, we don't always see that, do we? Sometimes it seems quite the opposite. Sometimes we look out at the world, it seems like the devil's winning, and unbelievers are winning. Sin is running rampant, and all kinds of false worldly ideas are floating around contrary to the Bible, and we may feel like we're on the losing side even. But that's only how it appears. One day, it will all become apparent that Jesus has been ruling. Jesus has been in control of everything all along. And so in the end, when will Jesus be clearly revealed as the King of all? Matthew 26, the high priest stood up and said to him, "Have you no answer? What is this? These men are testifying against you." But Jesus remained silent. Then the high priest said to him, "I place you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." Jesus said to him, "It is as you have said, but I tell you, soon you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." This is Jesus before the high priest, the night before his crucifixion. And the high priest puts him under oath and says, are you the Christ, the Son of the living God? And Jesus says, "Yeah, it is, as you said. But I know you don't see that now, and I know you don't believe that now, but there's a day when you will." And the day Jesus is talking about, when he comes down on the clouds of heaven, is going to be Judgment Day, right? And Revelation 1:7 says the same thing. "Look, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, including those who pierced him. And all the nations of the earth will mourn because of him." Yes, amen. On Judgment Day, everybody will see Jesus, including those who pierced him. Pierced him with their nails, but also pierced him with their sins. And all the nations of the earth will mourn because of him. To understand that properly, we have to realize that in the book of Revelation, believers are never called the nations of the earth. We are God's people. We are citizens of heaven. Unbelievers are the people of the earth. And all the unbelievers will mourn because of him. It will be a great day of sadness for them, because it will bring to light the fact that they rejected the very one that was king after all, that they were wrong. They will realize that they were very, very wrong. And so Jesus will clearly be revealed as King of all when he returns on the last day. On that day, the unbelievers will be forced to admit. We hear of that in the scripture, that every knee will bow and every tongue confess. The unbelievers will have to admit that Jesus was king after all. Now, they would do so to their shame, because he will say, "I never knew you," and cast them into eternal hellfire. On the other hand, it will be a day of great joy for us, because we will go, "That's what I believed all along. I knew it. God told me it. I never could see it, but now I do." We will be proven. It will be proven that we were not on the wrong side, that we were on the right side after all, even though we didn't always feel that way, even though the world told us otherwise, even though the devil shouted in our ear otherwise. On the last day, we and all who believe in Christ will be and worshiped him as Lord and King, will be, we have a word for that, vindicated. We will be proven to have been trusting in the right one, following the right one all along. As a king, what will Jesus do on that day? 1 Corinthians 15, "Look, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a moment, in a blink of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable and we will be changed." This section is talking only about believers on the last day and the resurrection of believers. All people will be raised from the dead, but not all will be changed to have a glorious body like Jesus. That only applies to believers. And so Jesus will raise all people from the dead. But as we say in the creed, and give unto me and all believers eternal life. He will raise all people from the dead, but only believers, to believers will he give eternal life. And here we have that here. Read Matthew 25, 31 to 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered in his presence, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was lacking clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? A few things we want to look at here so we don't misunderstand this section. Notice everybody will be in Jesus' presence. And then he will separate them from one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. It was common that during the day they would allow sheep and goats kind of to graze together, but then at night they would separate them into their own place. And that's the idea here. Jesus standing before the door to heaven, so to speak, and say, sheep come in, goats go away. Okay. Now, if we just read this verse, it might sound like we're getting to heaven by what we do, right? Our good works. Huh? If I feed a lot of hungry people and I donate a lot of clothing to poor people, well, then Jesus is going to let me in heaven. Not so fast. Notice, before he says any of that stuff, he separates them. And so it can't be that's the basis of the separation, can it? And then he also says to the sheep on his right, come you blessed by my Father, inherit. An inheritance is a gift. It's not something you earn. Prepared for you from the foundation of the world, before you were even born. And so Jesus is not saying, you know, these things, feeding the hungry and giving drink to the thirsty and clothing the people without clothes, visiting people in prison. Those aren't things that get us into heaven. Those are things we do because we are already going to heaven, because we are believers. Okay. Those are our fruits of faith. Okay. And that becomes evident if you look at the last verse on the screen. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? They're going, when did we do that, Lord? It's not like they were keeping track going, okay, now I'm doing good. God, look at me. Look at how good I am. No, they were just doing that because that's who they were. Okay. Because as Christians, we have that new heart that wants to love God and wants to love neighbor. No, we don't do it perfectly because we still have a sinful flesh that interferes, but that's what we want to do. And so we naturally do that at times, not for any other reason than that's who we are as children of God. The righteous, we know from scripture that describes believers, and we are not righteous because of our own performance, but we are righteous through faith in Jesus. God credits Jesus' perfect performance to us. So you have to read this section with all the stuff we've talked about already in mind. You can't just pull this out in isolation. Continues, When did we see you a stranger and welcome you? We're lacking clothes and clothe you. When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? The king will answer them, Amen, I tell you, just as you did it for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did it for me. So when we simply live out our Christian faith in Christian living, we are giving evidence of our faith. Remember, we talked about, we will talk about more good works next time. But, you know, for right now, let me just summarize it and say, you know, we do good works not to be saved, but because we are saved. And we'll talk more about that next week. On the other hand, verse 41, then he will say to those on his left, the unbelievers, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire, which is prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you did not give me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you did not give me anything to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Lacking clothes, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not take care of me. Then they will also answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or stranger or lacking clothes or sick or in prison and did not serve you? At that time he will answer them, Amen, I tell you, just as you did not do it for one of the least of these, you did not do it for me. Again, it wasn't, what was the problem? Why didn't they do these things? Remember, those are evidences of faith. The fact that they didn't have any evidences of faith showed that they didn't have faith. And so this whole section is Jesus simply saying, okay, you want to be, the verdict that I'm going to base on who gets to go to heaven and who goes to hell is going to be based on faith. Okay, that's the basis on which someone goes to heaven or not. Faith in Jesus as their Savior and Lord. And Jesus says, well, you want proof that my verdict is just? Okay, well, now let's look at the outward evidence of that faith. Okay, we call those fruits of faith, don't we? And so it's the works that Jesus talks about are not what keep someone out of heaven or bring someone into heaven. They're evidence of the lack of faith, which keeps someone out of heaven, or the presence of faith, which is the only way we can enter heaven. And they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. So what else will Jesus do on that day? I know we had a long discussion there, but if you want to just narrow it down for the question, he will bring believers to heaven and send unbelievers to hell. I went over that rather in detail because so many people, like to import all kinds of wrong ideas into it, and don't just take what the Bible says at face value. When will that day come? Matthew 24, no one knows when that day or hour will be, not the angels of heaven, not even the Son, but only the Father. The quick answer is no one knows except God. Now, remember we talked about that a little bit earlier in Jesus' state of humiliation. He says, not even the Son, okay? So Jesus doesn't know when he's coming back, no. But remember when he spoke those words, when he was in a state of humiliation, when he chose to be our Savior and so not to constantly and fully use his power and also his knowledge as God. So when he spoke those words, he chose not to know that. Now in his exaltation, after his descent into hell, resurrection, and ascension, yes, Jesus now has, once again, is making full use of that and constant use of that knowledge. So he does know now. So he wasn't lying. It's that mystery of the humiliation versus exaltation that we already looked at. Judgment day. A day coming at an unknown time when Jesus will return to bring believers to heaven and sentence unbelievers to hell. And remember, we already know the verdict. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. We don't have to wonder what's going to happen. So if anybody ever tells you, well, Jesus is coming back on this day, you can tell them, you're a liar, you're a false prophet, because they don't know. Jesus says no one knows except God. And after we're in heaven, what will Jesus do for us as our king? This is where it gets interesting. If you look at your passage sheet there, Revelation 7, or I'm sorry, you don't have a passage sheet. Revelation 7:16-17. I should have put this on the slide, but I didn't. So I'm going to read it to you. I'm not sure why it didn't get on there, but oh well. Revelation 7:16. They will never be hungry or thirsty ever again. There's a picture of heaven. The sun will never beat upon them, nor will any scorching heat. Now remember, in a desert area, that was a big comfort. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe every tear from their eye. Even in heaven, Jesus is still going to be our king. He's going to lead us to the little springs of living water. Even in heaven, Jesus is going to be taking care of us forever. And there it's going to be in all its fullness, because all our enemies will be gone. A thing of the past. Oh, there's the passage. Sorry about that. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, because all of sin and all the consequences of sin, which make us cry, will be a thing of the past. The question, how does Jesus serve as our king? He defeated all of our enemies when he died on the cross and rose from the dead. He rules all things for us now in eternity.